Is it know about some of the basic things about Java? Java architecture. Now we are going to discuss Java architecture. So before going to the Java architecture, so evaluation of Java. Who has been developed Java? I am going to discuss first. So those are key founders of Java: James Gosling, Patrick Nowerton, Chris Firth, E.D. Frank Sheridan. So these are the key founders of Java. So a team headed by James Gosling. These are the team members. Remaining totally a team of 6 members headed by James Gosling. So developed Java language. The origin of Java can be tracked back to the fall of 1992 and was initially called Vogue. So the Java was developed during 1992 by these 6 members team headed by James Gosling. Initially the name called as Vogue, Voake. Initially the name called as Vogue. This Vogue was renamed as Java in 1995. The 1995, the name Vogue renamed as Java. Java, there is no expansion. JABA, there is no expansion. So Java. Java was originally meant to be a platform neutral language. Platform neutral, also called as platform independent, both are same. Platform neutral, platform independent, both are same. So language for embedded software in devices. The goal was to move away from platform and OS specific compilers that would compile source for a particular target platform to language that would be portable and platform independent. The language could be used to produce platform neutral language. What is platform neutral? Platform neutral, different times they are given here. So the program whichever you have done already in C and C++, how it is going to compile, how it is going to execute, where it is going to execute. So in a Windows platform, you are writing a C++ program or C program, you are compiling it. Once if you are compiling it, which will generate an exe file, which will generating an exe file. Then if you want to execute that program, you need to execute that exe file. That exe file executes, it may ask you input, you may be provide some input, it will process, finally it will produce output. So these things will happen only in Windows platform. This exe file, if you are compiling, so the exe file is going to generate. That exe file will run only in Windows platform. It will not run in Linux platform or Unix platform or some other platform. So if you are creating and compiling and running your program in one platform, you can do it only one platform. You cannot move it to the some other platform. You cannot run it. That is called as a platform dependent. Platform dependent. What about Java? In Java, you can write your code. If you are compiling your Java program, which will generate bytecode. Which will generate bytecode. That bytecode can run on any platform: Windows, Linux, macOS, anything. In Java, if you are compiling the Java program, which will generate bytecode, that bytecode run on any machine, any OS. That's why we are telling Java is a platform neutral or platform independent language. If you are taking C and C++, these two are platform dependent language, because if you are compiling a program in one platform, so after compiling, we are getting exe file that run on same compiled platform, which we cannot move to the some other platform and we cannot run it. Here platform means OS. So this is the reason Java is a platform independent language. We are coming to the Java architecture. So this is simple diagram denoting Java architecture. So here generally the total Java architecture divided into two parts. One is compile time environment another one is runtime environment. One is compile time environment, another one is runtime environment. So within this compile time environment, so we can write Java code. We can write our Java program. So we can use any notepad, that is any editor. For example, notepad. You can use any editor to type our Java program. So once if you have typed our Java source code, we have to save that Java source code with extension .java. We have to save the program with extension .java. So in C, we have saved the program with .c. In C++, we have saved the program with .cpp. In Java, the program should be saved with extension .java. So once if you have created a Java source code, you can compile it using Java compiler. You can compile it using Java compiler. So if your program compiled successfully, no issue. If there is any error, the compiler will showing to you, you have to correct it and you have to recompile again. So if your program doesn't have any syntax error, if it is successfully compiled, which will produce bytecode. So what is the extension of that bytecode? Dot class. This bytecode file extension is dot class. So these are the things that happen at compile time. These are the things that happen at compile time. If your program is successfully compiled, it will produce bytecode. So what we can do, so this bytecode can run on the same OS platform. So where you have compiled, within the same platform, if you want to so run this program, you can run it, or you can move it to the some other system through network or through pen drive or through any device. You can copy from this compiled device to any other device, you can copy it, or through network you can transfer it, you can compile it. So while executing runtime environment, so first this bytecode should be loaded. The bytecode is called as in class file. Bytecode is called as in class file. So this class file should be loaded, which is loaded by class loader. Class loader loads the bytecode or class file. That's the thing. In addition to that, class loader loads some of the predefined class files. So in C, we have used predefined files. For example, stdio.h, string.h. So like that, we are using some of the predefined files. So in Java, we are using predefined classes. We can use predefined classes. Class loader loads the user-defined class file as well as predefined class files. Next, bytecode verifier verifies so whether bytecode is in correct format. Verifies whether loaded bytecode is in correct format or not. So because we are transferring this bytecode through network from one device to another device for running, so that's why during transmission the bytecode content may be changed, may be altered. That's why whether it is in correct format, whether it is going to be verified. Bytecode verifier verifies so whether bytecode follows Java constraints. There is no deviation in the Java constraints. So once it is loaded, then it is verified by Java bytecode verifier. Once it is verified, which is given to the JVM, Java Virtual Machine, So here Java Virtual Machine is called as Java Interpreter. Java Virtual Machine contains Java Interpreter and Just-in-Time Compiler, which help us to convert and execute our Java program. So what it is going to do, JVM convert bytecode into machine code. Java Virtual Machine convert bytecode into machine code. The machine code execute it. Then the machine code is executed. The operating system and So Java Virtual Machine contains Java Interpreter, Just-in-Time Compiler. We will see the difference between Java Interpreter, Just-in-Time Compiler. Both can be used for conversion from bytecode to machine code. So once bytecode is converted into machine code, so which is executed by processor or runtime system. So once a program is executing, which will ask user to enter input, user can enter input, then it processes it, finally it produces the output. So these are the things are going to happen. So Java compiler environment, what it is going to happen? So we are creating Java source code compiled by Java compiler. Once it is successfully compiled, which will produce Java bytecode, then this Java bytecode is the extension of Java bytecode is dot class. So this bytecode can be executed on same machine or which can be transferred to the some other machine through network, which can be executed. In execution, first process is class loader loads the bytecode. Bytecode verifier verifies the bytecode. So then JVM converts bytecode into machine code and executes it. Converts into bytecode. Converts Java virtual machine converts from bytecode to machine code, and it is executing our program. During execution, the program may interact with operating system and computer hardware. So these are the things are going to happen. This is the Java architecture. So once again, I read the steps: step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5. So what are the step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5 they are given? Step 1, create a Java source code with .java extension. Step 2, compilation. Compile the source code using Java compiler, which will create bytes code with file with .class extension. Next, step 3, class loader. Class loader reads both the user defined and library classes in. So class code as well as classes execution, there is a class loader is doing. Next, bytecode verifier validates all the bytecodes are valid and do not violate Java security restrictions. So bytecode verifier validates the bytecode and checks whether bytecode does not violate Java security constraints, which is checked. This is step 4. Bytecode verifier is step 4. Step 5 is Java virtual going to do JVM. It's short form JVM. Reads bytecodes and translates into machine code for execution. While execution of the program, the code will interact with operating system and hardware. Actually, these are the things are going to happen. This is architecture, basic architecture of Java. Here, this bytecode. Bytecode can run on any machine. It can run on any machine. Windows, if you are creating a Java source code in Windows, we can execute that Java bytecode on Windows OS, as well as we can execute that same Java bytecode in Linux, Mac OS, etc. The same bytecode can run on any machine. That's a point you have to remember. So the next point, that's why you're saying Java is a platform independent language. Create once, run anywhere. Create once, run anywhere. If you have created in one platform, then execute it on many platforms. That's why Java is called platform independent language. The next, what about JVM? Java Virtual Machine. You have to know little bit about Java Virtual Machine. What is this of Java Virtual Machine? Java Virtual Machine converts bytecode into machine code for execution. Java Virtual Machine converts bytecode into machine code for execution. JVM, little bit about JVM we have to discuss here. The output of the compiler is bytecode. The bytecodes are executed by JVM. It is an interpreter. JVM is an interpreter which converts the bytecode to machine specific instruction and executes. What JVM is going to do? Converts bytecode into machine specific instruction or machine code and executes it. all the process doing by JVM. Next, JVM is a platform recipe. JVM is a platform recipe. For Windows, there's a specific JVM. The same JVM cannot be used for Linux. Linux having separate JVM. Mac OS having separate JVM. Each and every OS having separate JVM, Java Virtual Machine. But every virtual machine can accept any type of bytecode. Any type of bytecode. Here, one thing you have to remember here, JVM is a platform specific. Each and every platform having separate JVM. What is OCaptJVM? JVM is an interpreter which converts the bytecode.